The date is December 1st, 1977. The place is 5024 Oakwood Road, the home of Dr. Eva B. Dykes, which is located, and a lovely home it is too, a three-bedroom rambler-type cottage opposite the Blake Center of Oakwood Cottage. The day is pleasant, although December 1st, brisk and clear, not too hot and not too cold. Now, Dr. Dykes, you know I'm very happy that you agreed to be included in this project of Radcliffe College, because Radcliffe is extremely proud of you as one, I think, the first of their PhD graduates, or among the first, and we'll come to that later. And we were all pleased when you decided that it was time now for the interview.
Well, I'm very glad that you are here. Whatever I can do to help you, I shall do.
Fine.
With pleasure.
Now, we like to begin with our roots. That's become extremely popular, of course, since Haley's roots.
Yes.
Anything that you wish to tell us about your parents or your grandparents, the background, your birth date, if you wish, and just any information on your background, we'd be very happy to have, because I know it's an important part of your later education and your excellent career.
Well, I had three uncles to graduate from Howard University before I was born. Two of them I never saw, but their names are listed in the directory of Howard University alumni. In addition to that, I had a baby sister who attended the academy at Howard. Then I had a sister, Florence, who was in the School of Education to graduate from Howard. My father also was a graduate from Howard University. And for that reason, Dean Cook would often call me a daughter of the university.
Interesting. Now, where were you born?
I was born in Washington, D.C., August 13th,
1893. Oh. Now, your parents were born in the nearby area or in the Washington region?
My father was born in Maryland, in a Catholic, where the Catholics settled, as you know. And my mother was born also in Maryland. But she came to Washington at a very early age when she was a child. My grandparents moved from Maryland to D.C. It was in a section of Washington on the outskirts. The boundary was about five blocks from where I lived.
Oh, yes.
But the section where I was born is now included in the Washington area.
Do you remember anything about your grandparents, or either from your memory or hearsay?
Well, I remember something that I can appreciate very well now, since I am a senior citizen. I can remember passing him on the street and saying, "How do, Dr. Mr. Howard?" And he didn't know exactly who we were because he couldn't see too well.
It was your grandfather?
It was my grandfather. And he would say, "How do, children?" and go right on leisurely.
And his name was Howard?
Yes, his name was Howard.
Uh-huh. Interesting. John now, that's Howard. Your paternal or your maternal grandfather?
Paternal.
I see.
Mm-hmm.
And he was, you mentioned, and he was born in the Maryland area.
He was born in Maryland.
Yes. Do you know, remember your maternal grandmother or grandfather?
Yes, I remember her. She was born in Maryland also.
Yes. Well, you're more fortunate than I am. I do not know my grandparents. I know them, but
yes.
They were deceased before I was
born.
Yes,
yes.
And I've never had the pleasure of a grandmother.
Well, I was fortunate enough to have the pleasure of both a grandfather and a grandmother. For this I am grateful.
Yes. So you were born in Washington, or right on the outskirts of Washington, and you spent, obviously, your first years there.
Yes, I did.
In those days, they didn't have kindergarten, nursery schools, and so on, did they? They went to school at 5, like I did when I was 5 in Michigan.
Yes, yes.
And where did you go?
Well, early years, I went to Howard University.
Howard University?
To the training school, grades 1 through 4.
Oh, that's different.
I spent at Howard University in the training school for teachers.
Okay.
And then grades 5 through 8, as far as the elementary period is concerned, I spent at Lucretia Mott School.
Oh, yes.
But it's now Lucretia Mott School.
That's just on 6th Street down the hill
south from Howard.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I think it's one of the model schools now where practice teachers.
Oh, is that so?
I think so.
Oh, I see.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
It's one of the better schools in terms of teaching, I understand.
Oh, uh-huh.
I suppose now the school is where the president's daughter is attending. But Lucretia Mott
yes.
was before that time.
Yes, that's right.
That's interesting. Then you said you were, from Lucretia Mott, where did you go? Which
I
high
went
school?
To M Street High School.
Oh,
it was
yes.
called M Street at that time.
Yes.
Now it is known as Dunbar
yes.
in Washington.
That's the finest. That the one that has prepared so many people
yes.
for the Eastern colleges and universities.
Oh, mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And you did your 4 years there.
Yes. And then I went to Howard University.
Yes. Did you have any special interest or special field of interest while you were at Dunbar?
No, I liked Latin.
Yes.
I also liked English. I liked mathematics.
Oh, interesting.
Although one of my highest grades was received in mathematics, it is a subject that I didn't care to go into. I don't think I'm fully capable of being a mathematics teacher.
I see. Who were some of your, do you remember any of your teachers at Dunbar High School?
Yes, I remember a teacher by the name of Parker Bailey. He was very interesting in English. I also had Mr. Glenn as one of my teachers, and Harriet Shad.
Oh, Harriet Shad.
Harriet
I
Shad
knew her.
Oh,
she
did
was
you know
in,
her?
She was the, yes,
mm-hmm.
the oldest member in one of my bridge clubs.
Oh,
is
that so?
And she died about 6 or 7 years ago.
Six or seven.
Six or seven years
so?
Ago.
Well,
very
I didn't
fair
know.
Person
very
that
fair.
Could pass for
very
white.
Very fair, that's right.
And a very elegant and
yes.
And correct lady.
Yes, she was. And she was very attractive,
oh, yes.
in my opinion.
Yes.
I used to sit in the class and look at her, and she would talk to us and admire her beauty.
Yeah. Then from Dunbar, did you want to go away? So many students at Dunbar are in preparation for an Eastern college. Certainly in the past, so many of our outstanding Negroes were at Dunbar, and then they
mm-hmm.
went on to Harvard or Williams or Yale.
Well, since many of the people in my family were graduates of Howard, I wanted to go to Howard.
You did?
Mm-hmm. So for that reason, I didn't have any hesitation about Howard. I felt as if it was a school that was in our city, and at that time it was, I think it was one of the best black schools that we had.
Well, it was.
Although it doesn't have the standing it has then, it doesn't have the standing then that it has now.
But I bet they learned more.
Well,
they didn't have as many distractions.
Yes, yes.
Television and...
No, we
and,
didn't have
and
television,
and,
radio.
And marches and marches and
mm-hmm.
protest marches and so on.
We did have what was known as college days when we
yeah.
would pretend that we were people of all types.
Oh, yeah.
And we dressed in probably costumes that might not be very suitable now. But we would wear long dresses, and some of us would pretend that we were mothers, and I used to have a picture holding a doll in my arms. In fact, we dressed as if we were bums rather than college students,
oh,
but that made it very interesting.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Were you there at the time? No, that would be getting into World War One. The period when they had the army,
ROTC.
They were ROTC,
yes,
and the
there.
Parade at 4 o'clock was the big event at. On our campus, I understand, and people in the city would dress and come out to be present for the parade. I've heard
well,
that
I'm sure.
Over.
Is that so?
Yes.
I don't remember that exactly. It could have happened while I was there. That's been so very
or maybe
many,
when
many
you
years
were,
ago.
Yeah, or maybe when, even when you were in high school.
Probably
come
so.
In at that period.
Mm-hmm.
But it was the social event of the afternoon.
Oh, it was?
Yes, to dress in almost in your Sunday go meeting
oh,
type
I,
of clothes
I,
to watch the parade at
oh,
Howard University.
Oh, I see.
What was your special interest at Howard?
I didn't have a special interest. I took Latin 4 years, German 4 years, English 4 years. And at that time, I didn't know exactly what I was going to be. And that happens in many cases. Many
yes.
students enter college not having, not determined particularly what they wanted to be in life. I took mathematics, German, Latin, and English 4 years the whole time I was at Howard University.
Yes, but those were very, very basic subjects.
Yes,
you didn't jump around one semester this, the next semester something.
No.
I find students, and then when they finish, they have no ability in any one field.
But that isn't strange. Many educators say that when students, some students enter college, they really don't know what they want to be in life until their senior year. I read an article similar to that in a magazine, that we shouldn't be surprised if some students don't know before they go to college exactly what they want to be. But by the time they finish college, they have had a sampling of the various subjects taught, and they make up their minds after they have finished or near graduation time.
Yes.
But sometimes we think that students make up their mind, or young people make up their minds when they're small, and some of them do. And then there are others who are undecided, and then college helps to settle their
yes.
minds.
Which is fine,
mm-hmm.
in a way, if it does that. Sometimes it doesn't.
That's right.
Now, then you did 4 years at Howard University
yes.
and received the baccalaureate
mm-hmm.
degree. Well, now, where does Radcliffe come in?
Well, my uncle wanted me to get my master's degree. At that time, Howard was not accredited. And for that reason, the registrar wrote back and said I would have to attend Radcliffe so that they could determine what type of work I would do. So my uncle decided to have me go there as an unclassified student and also get another AB from a school that was accredited at that time.
Yes.
And that's what I did.
Fine.
I went to Radcliffe as an unclassified student, and after I had been there 1 year, then I was classified as a senior. So I got my A.B. from Radcliffe. Many people have asked me, why did I get another A.B. from Radcliffe? But
well,
my uncle made the decision.
Yes, and that's fine. Then you went right on for a further...
I taught 1 year.
Oh, you did.
At a school in Nashville, Tennessee, named Walden University. And I had a very splendid English teacher by the name of David Houston. And he said to us that the most important thing, or one of the most important thing, was not your experience in college, but the experience that you could get as a teacher. So he told me that if we wanted to, we should teach if we could. And I did that. And I was paid $25 a month with my expenses at Walden University. It no longer exists, but it was at that time situated in Nashville, Tennessee.
Yeah, I see. Oh, well, you mentioned Houston. Now, he later came to Washington. Is it the Houston I associate?
David Houston.
As being a scholar?
Yes,
very
he was
scholarly.
A scholar. Yes, he was.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And I knew his daughter.
Oh, you did? He had
yes.
two daughters, I think.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, that's fine. They must have moved to Washington, or maybe he was in teaching there, but his residence was even in Washington at the time.
Yes. And he died, and his wife died also. He used to live on T Street, Northwest in Washington.
Oh, yes. That's the
Washington.
Same Houston.
Same Houston.
Yes. Now then, you went on. Did you take a master's or go straight through after you were admitted to the PhD?
I went straight through.
I see.
I received my master's, and then I decided to work on my uncle yeah. wanted me to work upon a PhD. So I was there, stayed, and worked on the PhD.
This, you mentioned, I think, just told me once that you had some scholarships while you were there.
Yes, I had 5 scholarships, and they enabled me, they were semester scholarships, they enabled me to very much, they were very helpful, and that, in addition to the fact that my uncle sent me money, enabled me to finish successfully as far as finances were concerned.
Fine.
So then I didn't have to worry about how I was going to get my money.
Well,
but my uncle made a deep sacrifice himself to send me through school.
That means then that your uncle was a primary influence in your life,
in
terms of your
education. Yes.
This is interesting because I found in interviewing 2 or 3 other people that the father was an important factor.
Yes, yes.
And I suppose that may be because if we're thinking of the early part of this century, maybe the men had gone on and had a college or university education.
Yes,
and
yes.
This uncle had that opportunity?
And yes, I had three uncles to graduate from Howard University. Yes. My mother graduated from went to the university, but she had to stop because of illness. But I did have two sisters. One went to the academy, and the other one finished at Howard. She is now deceased.
Now, then there is a background of members of your family being
interested
in education.
Yes.
You never had anyone say, well, why are you keeping your head in the book?
Never.
That isn't going to do you any good.
And although my father had left my mother, separated from my mother, he, before he was even married, received his degree from Howard University.
Well, then you...
So I had three uncles. Two died before I was born.
Yeah.
Two sisters to attend Howard. One graduated from the academy, and
yes,
the other one from college.
Yes.
And a father.
Well, then Howard has played... Howard and Radcliffe and Oakwood have together played the major influences in your life.
In my life,
yes. Now, your special interest at Radcliffe, after being accepted, registered, and going on for graduate work, was in literature.
Yes.
And which literature, primarily?
It was in English Lit, but I took a number of courses. At that time, we had to take courses foreign to English. I took Gothic, which is a dead language. I also, although I had had German at Howard, I also passed a course in German, an examination rather,
yes,
in German.
To qualify for the PhD.
To qualify,
yes.
You have to have a reading knowledge of German and French. Did
I
you have to do that?
Well, two foreign languages, and those are the ones
I
chose, too. Yes.
Well, I decided to take my oral examination in French because that was akin to Latin. And although I had had only 1 year of French in a school, I passed it because of my knowledge of Latin.
Oh, that background.
Yes,
Latin.
Being one of the Romance languages.
But do you? I read French quite rapidly. I used to read it and not realize I was reading a foreign language, maybe until I was on page 250, and then I'd have to use the dictionary.
Oh, yes.
But I couldn't have done it in 1 year.
Mm-hmm.
But it was because of your Latin background, I suppose.
Yes,
did
the Latin
you find
helped.
German difficult?
No, it wasn't difficult, but I never liked it particularly.
I see.
But I didn't find it difficult as far as studying is concerned.
How long were you working for the PhD degree? Do you remember about how long?
Oh, I imagine about 3 or 4 years.
Mm-hmm. That's good.
Mm-hmm.
From the PhD.
I took 1 year off and went to... visit the historical societies of Philadelphia. There was one in Philadelphia, Historical Society of Pennsylvania. I visited a historical society in connection with Massachusetts. That was in Boston. My teacher wanted me to go to North Carolina, but I couldn't go because I was black, so I couldn't attend the historical society there. But on the other hand, I was able to go through without meeting prejudice, which might damage me mentally.
Yes.
Didn't have any effect upon me. I just decided to go on to some other place.
Yes. Well, that's fine.
And my uncle always told us that the people who were prejudiced were victims, and not oppressors. Many of them were victims of the type of education they had received when they were younger. For that reason, it made me have a different outlook upon people who were prejudiced. I didn't hate them. My uncle had always taught me never to hate anybody, no matter how I was treated. But he said that they were the ones who were the unhappy persons, not the victim, but the perpetrator.
Yes, I think there's a great deal of truth in that.
Mm-hmm.
Now, obviously, you had to write a dissertation for your PhD degree. What was the subject of that?
Popes. Influence in America from 1910 to 1950.
Oh, Alexander.
Oh. Yes, influence. His influence exerted itself for a long time, as you know, after he was dead. And that is true in many cases. of leading characters in literature.
Yes.
In fact, now many people are influenced by dead writers.
Yes, mm-hmm. That's true. More after their death than during the living period.
Yes,
and
yes.
They often become famous after death.
After death, mm-hmm. They do. One interesting thing about Pope was that so many people think of him as a classicist, but he was a romanticist as far as his attitude toward slavery, toward the oppressed,
yes.
was concerned.
And that carried over, too, did it not, to the working class in England? Did he have concern for that group, like the people in the factories and so on?
I don't know about people in the factories, but I do recall the Indian. He was interested particularly in the Indian. And in his works, we do find references to freedom. Yes, I think he mentions a slave
yes.
in one of his works,
yes.
just as William Cowper did
yes.
during that same period.
And your degree was in...
Alexander Pope and his influence in America.
That was a dissertation.
Yes, from 1710 to 1850.
Yes.
I stopped there.
Yes. The degree was in what subject? What specific subject?
Well, I thought it was English, but when I got my diploma, it read English philology.
Oh, philology. Yeah. Well, that's interesting. Now, you received your degree, I believe, in 1921. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. The PhD degree?
I imagine so. I should remember the exact
yeah,
year.
Yeah, I think so.
But there were three of us to get the degree. Same year.
Yes. Now, that when I first came to Washington, I heard much about that. Who were those three?
Sadie Alexander Marcel from the University of Pennsylvania.
Yes.
And Georgiana Simpson from
Georgiana
the University
Simpson.
Of Chicago.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And I knew Dr. Simpson. She was here
did you know
at
her?
Howard when I came.
Were you there
or she
when
was
she
in
died?
Washington. Yes.
You were there at that time?
I don't know whether she was still teaching when I came, but I did go to her for some, not exactly tutoring, because I had several years of German,
mm-hmm.
but when some points would come up in German that I didn't really understand,
her.
And I would go to her home,
mm-hmm.
which was in Southeast Washington, down beyond the Library of Congress, somewhere
yes.
down in that area.
Yes.
And, of course, you know how she died.
Yes, it was very sad.
Yes.
She fell asleep, as many of us do when we are studying. And while she was asleep, the gas came on, and she never...
Of course, that was the easy way to go, but asphyxiation.
Yes, quiet way.
It was
mm-hmm.
a shock, though,
But we were very shocked.
Because she wasn't decrepit by any means.
No,
she seemed to be quite physically able, and
mm-hmm.
might have been around until now.
But it impressed us. We were very much saddened by her death.
Yes.
When it was reported
now,
to us.
As I recall, when I came to Washington in 1942, and of course I passed through many times before
mm-hmm.
and knew any number of people here, but it was always a question, what colored woman received the PhD first? And there was always an argument, which one of the three of you?
Well, if you're going to say there were really three women, there were three women who received it.
The same year.
Same year.
And the same June, I suppose. May or June. I imagine June, the commencement.
Yes, the question might occur as to the time of the graduation
yes.
class. That appears.
Yes.
Now, I had always thought that Sadie Simpson was the first one to receive hers as far as the time was concerned, but
yes.
I found out it was Georgiana Simpson.
Oh, is that so?
Yes, she received hers first. Her graduation was earlier. She got hers from the University of Chicago.
Yes.
Sadie Marcel was next, University of Pennsylvania. And Radcliffe was next.
But you finished your work.
I just merely happened to qualify first.
Oh.
And some of the teachers at Dunbar were so gratified or so pleased that they said they didn't think, and they said that I was the first one to receive it. But actually, all three of us received it at the same graduation time.
I'm glad that you have straightened, at least for me, the record, because I've heard so many conflicting statements.
And I really happened to qualify for it first. That was the only thing.
And it doesn't seem to make a great deal of difference.
No,
because
three people received it in the same year.
Yeah.
That's right.
And probably the same month.
And I think the same... I think we graduated from Radcliffe last. I think our graduation day was later.
I see.
I think so.
Yes.
But I will call the names of many of the people under whom I worked were so pleased, and they didn't know that these other people were going to come up, and that's how that rumor started.
Oh.
I may say that I was the first one to get it in English.
You may
stop there.
And not too many get it in English today. I can tell
that
you
so?
That. I know any number who attempt to get it in English, and they never do, from Harvard and Radcliffe.
Mm-hmm.
You were the first then of our race to finish with a PhD from Radcliffe. There's no question about that.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Well, that's to me clears the record.
Yes.